This book came out very recently. It's almost, it came almost from the printing house, and it's the book by Menachem Klein that we will talk about today. And if you think it's interesting, you have the chance in the back to buy the book, and maybe you will sign it even for people who like that. So I'll put it here for everybody to see. We have, I think, a very, very nice image for the title. And if I interpret that right, it is, I'm not so sure, three Jewish and one Palestinian item. If the black cap next to the kafiyah is not, it doesn't look like it's a Palestinian sculpture. So this really represents, I think, the political situation in Jerusalem. And this picture leads us already inside the talk. But let me tell you a little bit about Menachem Klein, and I have to use my Spickzettel because I wrote it down. Menachem Klein is a scholar of Middle East and Islamic studies. He's a faculty member of the Department of Political Science at Bar-Ilan University in Ramat Gan, Israel, far away from Jerusalem. His assignment as visiting professor and research fellow testifies international standing. He taught and researched at the Oxford University in the UK, MIT in Boston, the European University Institute in Florence, Leiden University in the Netherlands, King's College in London, and the Bruno Kreisky Forum in Vienna, so very international. He is a consultant in demand of many institutions, ranging from political facilities in Israel to national and international official and unofficial negotiations concerning the Palestinian-Israeli relations. He was a board member of B'Tselem, an Israeli NGO looking after human rights behavior in the occupied territories. His book, Lives in Common Arabs and Jews in Jerusalem, Jaffa and Hebron, was awarded by the New Republic as one of the best nonfiction books in 2014. A slightly shortened version just have been published by Suhrkamp Verlag under the title, and here it is, Jerusalem geteilt, vereint, Araber und Juden in einer Stadt. And I'm pretty sure this book will be one of the best nonfiction books this year in Germany. So I read the book with great enthusiasm, and I want to start questioning Menachem Klein with a proverb that he uses, which I like very much. He uses in the book for Palestine by Arthur Koestler and applied to Jerusalem. Jerusalem is the size of a city, but with conflicts of a continent. And maybe, and I like that very much because it's so very true. It is, I think, one of the most controversial cities in the world. And the best for me, and I have a hate-love for Jerusalem, I have to admit. I love it and hate it in the same time. But applied to Israel, what I like best in Jerusalem now is the climate. And if you don't have a sympathy for wet, humid heat, then you have to go to Jerusalem because the climate is there much better. So maybe you can a little bit circle around that image of a city-sized city with heavy conflicts.
Okay, thank you very much. But first of all, I would like to thank you for coming in such a hot day and humid in Berlin. I walked there outside for, let's say, 10, 15 minutes, and okay, it's a tough mission to go, and thank you for coming. Thank you very much for hosting me and organizing, and also the exhibition in Jerusalem, Welcome to Jerusalem, is fantastic, very rich. I recommend you visiting upstairs the exhibition, which I also have some, you know, part in helping you to develop it. And I would like also to thank to Eva Maria, who translated this book. It could not be produced, and you could not read it or enjoy it. I hope that you enjoy it. I'm sure that you enjoy it. Without the professional work done by Eva Maria, I don't read German, unfortunately. But I am fully trust that she made a great job. I also would like to thank to Suhrkamp for publishing it so nicely, being so professional in producing the book, and giving me the chance to join a long list of very honorable and respectable authors published by Suhrkamp. So I'm very, very thankful to all. Jerusalem, of course, what we have in mind is the conflict in Jerusalem. Okay, so Jerusalem always is in the news due to the conflict. And even this time, in particular next week, when the American embassy will open in a big ceremony on Monday, we have very soon, in 1 week time, also the Israeli Jews commemorate the Jerusalem Day, according to the Jewish calendar, commemorating the Israeli occupation, or for other people, liberation of East Jerusalem. So these two events, the opening of the American embassy, unilaterally declared by President Trump, and the commemoration day, Jerusalem Day, which for the Israelis, many Israelis, not all Israelis, but many Israelis, is a happy day. For the Palestinians, is a very sad day, commemorating their losing and occupation in 67 war. Definitely, this will bring, this will create more tension in Jerusalem. It will, and it will, the conflict will be shown in the news. Jerusalem will be once again in the news due to the conflict. And it's not easy to live in Jerusalem. I live in Jerusalem for many, many years. It's not easy. Indeed, it's Jerusalem is relatively a very small place. I mean, the core, Jerusalem, the historical core. The old city is less than 1 square kilometer. Okay, so 1 square kilometer creates hundreds or thousands of years of problems and wars. But what I tried to do in this book is something a little bit different, different than showing only the wars and the tension in Jerusalem. Many books were published on Jerusalem struggle between three religions or between two nations. I asked, and when I started researching the subject, what were the daily encounters between Jerusalem citizens in the public space? What happened when they meet in the bazaar, in school, holy places, you name it. And then I went back to the late 19th century and wrote a book about 150 years of an everyday life encounter between Jerusalemites. So the perspective is from within, not from the outside. Many books gives the, or almost all the books that I know, give the perspective from the outside, the conquerors, the Crusades, the Salah ad-Din, whoever, all the wars, war after war after war. But what happens between the wars? What happened to the average citizen in the street, in the school, and so on? How they interact? These are the questions that led me to write this book. And definitely the wars and the struggle, the struggles are part of the city. Definitely when, okay, I live in the city, I go quite often abroad, as you heard, to teach, to do my research, sabbaticals. When I come back to the city, I can feel the tension. Even the body language of the Jerusalemites is different than the body language of the Tel Aviv residents. You feel in Tel Aviv, you feel relief. In Jerusalem, it's much more tense. Even if we don't have terrorist attacks or ultra-Orthodox demonstrations or whatever. It's a heavy place, I must say. It's heavy because of the history, it's heavy because of its holiness, it's heavy because of the conflicts, but we have to bear in mind that normal people live in the city, and it is a city, which means with schools, with sewage, with garbage collection, with everything that you can find in every other city. And so this perspective is missing, but I brought here the voice of the people themselves, how they see, how they interact with each other prior to nationalism, during the wars and conflict, and in between, up to date. So the book covers 150 years, which of course at the main conflict in the city is between Israelis and Palestinians, and this is the this creates a tension in the city between the East and the West.
When we look at pictures from earlier times, and we have some in the exhibition. For instance, when the university first opened, the Hebrew University on Mount Scopus, you see all kinds of people on the photographs. You see Arabs, you see Jews, you see people in normal suits, you see people with a kafia. So you have the impression there was a time, it was even when the Yishuv, the Jewish settlement, was created, when there were much closer relationships between Arabs and Jews, not only on a private level, but also on an official level. We have in the exhibition photographs of the King David, of the early times of the King David, where meetings took place between the Zionist organization and Arab organizations. Can you highlight on that a little bit? It looks strange from today, because today we have a very total separation.
Definitely, and I must tell you that I was fascinated by while writing the book, or when I do my research, I did my research and spent hours in archives and libraries, and I was fascinated by the rich documents that I found on, and it's more than coexistence. It's a kind of a shared space between Jews and Arabs up to 48. And definitely Jews and the Arabs shared the city together. And King David was very famous because it was a kind of a club where the local elite met, the Jewish elite, let's say the lawyers, the journalists, major journalists, and the British. King David was opened in the 30s. 1930s. The British mandatory seniors and the Palestinian elite, and there were salons opposite to King David. There is the YMCA, the swimming pool, tennis court, concerts. Not far from there were cinemas, the Rex Cinema, Zion Cinema, showing Arab films, regular films. So the city center, the coffee shops in Jaffa Street were joined, were shared by everybody. There were, of course, Arab coffee shops, typical Arab coffee shops with Arab music. Just a few meters behind, there were European coffee shops, very typical to any West European city. So Jerusalem was, up to 48, a cosmopolitan, and I mean cosmopolitan in the sense of the Middle East, but it was a cosmopolitan city. I have here data on the foreign languages the Jerusalemites know and use and spoke. So it was multilingual, it was multicultural, in kind of a cosmopolitan society, and it was very, very interesting mix of a city, a Middle Eastern city. It was very, very different from what we have today, of course. But this was like Cairo, let's say, during the first half of the 20th century, or Beirut later on. Very, very open-minded, cosmopolitan. And bear in mind that Jaffa was the harbor and the gate from the west, that anyone who came to pilgrimage or tourist and to visit Jerusalem entered from Jaffa and came to Jerusalem. You can see, you have here up in the exhibition a photograph, I think from the late 1870s, I think. And for Jaffa Gate area. So you can see in the Jaffa Gate area, for instance, titles of business not in Arabic, in English. Also, there is a Deutsche Bank title there. So with the foreign consuls coming, showing greater interest in the Middle East and in the Holy Land, in Jerusalem, the West came to Jerusalem with its cosmopolitan, with the modernization, and Jerusalem was very, Jerusalem in reality was very, very different from the bad reputation of the Ottomans, okay, the declining empire. The Ottoman Empire was ending in the center, but in the periphery, like Jerusalem, modernization prevailed and changed the city. So it was a very, very different, open-minded society, many interactions, and it was not dominated by religious sects. So the division between Muslims, Christians, and Jews was much, much less than it was during the medievals. So mixed marriage, for instance, I have here in the book, I found that mixed marriage was well known at that time, and during also up to 48. I decided not to include any general conclusion about mixed marriage, only and include in the book couples that I know, or one, the groom or the bride, origin that I can find in sources, the name. And I have here names, and it was well known, it was not legitimate, but tolerated. And it was a very common custom, illegitimate, but common, the mixed marriage between Palestinians and Jewish women and so on. So it was very, very different. Now, this social history, or this side of the Jerusalem society, is just starting to be exposed by historians. Just starting to expose. And the new wave today of history writing or rewriting the history of the city prior to 48 goes in this way. So asking very different questions, not who started the war, but how life was in the city. What were the social relations between Jews, Arabs, and Muslims, or Israeli, Jews and Arabs. And bear in mind that not every Jew was Zionist. And not necessarily every Jew who came on a Zionist certificate to immigrate was really indeed a committed Zionist.
So I had the impression that Jerusalem, which I know from the mid-60s, was, for me, the least Israeli city. And that's what I liked. I came to Israel in 66, and I had to spend, I was forced, actually, to spend half a year in a kibbutz. That was the plan by the Jewish agency. And I hated the kibbutz. I didn't like it there. And then we went to study to Jerusalem, and I liked Jerusalem as a non-pioneer city. And it was a completely secular city, secular to the point that when by accident you would get close to the Orthodox quarter, Me'er Shearim, it came to my head, oh, Jews are living here. That means that it didn't feel to live in Jerusalem among Jews. This has dramatically changed. By now, what happened in the past, let's say, 40 years? Dramatic changes.
Sure, but it's a very interesting question, and I started thinking while you ask. Okay, started thinking on my answer. Perhaps, and here I would like to offer a hypothesis. Perhaps we have to change our perception on who is or what is Israeli identity. So if you say Jerusalem in the 50s, early 60s, prior to 67, was not an Israeli city, it means that Israeli identity was created by the labor movement, by the kibbutz, and so on. This is the very good marketing of the Israeli, let's say, the Exodus film, or the book, Leon Uris, very successful marketing of the new Israeli identity. Was it real or imagined? Well, I think it was real only in part of the land, the kibbutzim, the pioneers, the labor movement. But if you go to Jerusalem at that time, you go to Tel Aviv, you go to Jaffa, to other places, it was a very different society. What changed is that the immigrants, the labor movement declined, the immigrants took over with the neglected or the deprived communities like the Orthodox or national religious and so on. And now we have a different society with different perception, we have a different perception of the society. The city has changed. Now, the argument of many in Israel, Jerusalemites and people who live outside Jerusalem, is if you want to know how Israel looks like, it's like Jerusalem. Jerusalem is the real expression or model of Jerusalem, not Tel Aviv. Don't be confused. Tel Aviv is a bubble. Jerusalem is real Israel, with the Arab Palestinians, with the conflict, with the ultra-Orthodox, with the Oriental Jews. This is Israel. Now, demographically speaking, 10% of the Israeli population live in Jerusalem. 10%. So all Israeli society segments are presented in Jerusalem. It's more, let's say, reflects more the Israeli society than, let's say, North Tel Aviv, which I like, but that's I like to escape from Jerusalem to Tel Aviv. Feel like I'm abroad, but this is not the real country. But definitely you are right. The perception that the labor movement created of Israel, the new Israel, the hero, the fighter, the pioneer, that's not Jerusalem.
Well, if we look at the Jewish part of West Jerusalem, you talk in your book, you use the term Arab Jews, which now is introduced into the discussion on what used to be called Oriental Jews, Jews from Arab countries. That was, I think, the biggest part of the population in Jerusalem, in West Jerusalem, with the enclave of German refugees in Rehavia. And I think it's the only city where this group of people, or the sons and daughters of Jews from Arab countries, started a little revolution. They called themselves the Black Panthers, and that was the only protest, big protest movement that happened in Israel after the Six-Day War. And I think that's interesting. Maybe you can talk a little bit about that, because the Six-Day War opened the city. The city became much bigger. You could go to the east side. We did that, I have to say, with a lot of fear, and that says much about the way the Jewish side looked at the Arab side. It wasn't easy to go there. We were afraid. We didn't know what would happen. I think from the Arab side, there was also suspicion to come to the west side. But so everything was open, and the city invented itself new, but the Black Panthers took their chance.
Okay, I must say that I did not have any fears or concerns going to the East City. I used to go as a young kid many, many times, even, let's say, skip my high school classes in order to go to the bazaar. There was no, okay, so on. Now in London, where I stay now, and elsewhere, I'm sure also here, you commemorate this 68 revolution, okay? So I remember quite well the 68 spirit of in Jerusalem. It was the it was, let's say, in Israel, it was the place where all the beatnik, the 60s generation, came. Drugs, spending all night on the old city walls near Damascus Gate, or up there above Damascus Gate, with singing with guitars, playing guitar, eating hummus, and just down the and near the gate, and so on. It was the center of all the beatniks, hippies, and the happy Israelis, happy Palestinians. And in 68, the late 60s, the Woodstock atmosphere was there in the city without any fear and so on. There were a few clashes, few terrorist attacks here and there, but nobody count them as real threat. Very, very different from what we have in the city since the first Intifada, definitely the second Intifada. Now, What you said, very rightly, on the Oriental Jews or the Arab Jews. So the Arab, I write about the Arab Jews, which I mean are Jews that were integrated and part of the Arab culture, Arab language, Arab culture, it's a local culture. Actually, there was a local identity from the late 19th century, early 20th century, a local identity that Jews and Arabs shared. And I also include in this definition Ashkenazi Jews. Ashkenazi Jews were also part of this identity of local patriots or local identity, which I call Arab Jews. So there is, I suggest having a new perspective on the Ashkenazi Jews. There was the division between Ashkenazi and Oriental Jews was not as it is today, or it was after 48, definitely. Now, what happens in the after 48 is that the war in 48 divided Jews from Arabs. The Arab Jews, prior to 48 war, were divided from their Arabs. They became Israelis and Zionists, but they were veterans. Israel brought many Jews from Arab countries, North Africa, Morocco, Iraq, mass immigration, Yemenis, also another wave of Yemenis. And Israel put them on the outside ring of Jerusalem. So there was the core of West Jerusalem, the city center, the core, where the veteran residents lived, the Ashkenazi or the Rehavia, or what we call Arab Jews, that were also part of this veteran community. And in the periphery, there were, we can say, new immigrants, newcomers, refugees from Arab countries, you name it. But Israel put them on the borderline with Jordan. And in many cases, in the borderline, the newcomers went into houses that the Palestinians left. The nice houses in West Jerusalem, of the Palestinian nice houses, were occupied by privilege, Ashkenazi Jews and establishment people. Okay, so the establishment kept the nice villas of Talbiye and Baka for itself. For the newcomers, they throw them to the borderline, let's say Musrara area near Nablus Gate. And then they started a protest, the Black Panthers. They took the name, it's very interesting, because the name originated in the Black Panthers of America, the blacks against the whites. It was adopted as part of the 60s culture, by the Israeli blacks, which are let's say darker skin, their skin is darker than the Ashkenazi whites, so-called, and they started a revolt against the privileged establishment, the labor movement. Golda Meir was then the prime minister, and this led definitely to the elections in 77 when Begin came to power. They voted for the opposition against the establishment that deprived them. That denied them their identity and also denied their original identity. The labor movement tried to impose on them the labor movement values, the pioneer culture, etc., which they did not feel as belonging to this.
This is interesting. I never thought of that. That this protest votes And if you look at the United States who voted for Trump, that protest voters voted against the Labour Party because the Labour Party was defined by Western European and Eastern European mainly, not German. German Jews had nothing to do with it, from a Polish and Russian Jews coming to Israel. And they voted for the personification of an Eastern European Jew, a right-wing Eastern European Jew, as opposed to the left-wing Eastern European Jew, and introduced a completely change of society. I understand something now which I never really understood. That's very interesting. But coming to a very different cultural side of the city, and you mentioned it also in your book, and if you speak about coffee houses, the center of Jerusalem in the 60s and 70s was a cinema, something completely apolitical. It was a cinema. It was called the Zion Cinema on the Zion Square. And this was the center of the city, and there was a ritual in Jerusalem. You know, in Israel, on Saturday, everything is closed. On Friday, late noon, everything closes down. And everybody went to a last picture show in a cinema, saw a really bad Western film, but that it didn't matter what you saw in the cinema. But you had to go to the cinema, and the cinema consisted, the film screen had three languages, subtitles, so you hardly could see anyway what was going on the screen, but it was a ritual that for me defined Jerusalem. Can you comment on that?
Definitely this. Zion Square, which is still, the square is there, but the cinema is finished, destroyed in order to build a very ugly building instead. But this was the city center. This was the downtown Jerusalem. Actually, the city center was the Zion Square, which is very close to Jaffa Gate. Now, when Jerusalem opened towards the west, and I said it's not symbolically, but also culturally and politically, Jerusalem opened, I mean, getting out from the walls, old city walls, from Jaffa Gate to the west, towards Jaffa. So nearby is Zion Square, and Jaffa Road and Zion Square. And the Zion Square were Alaska Cafe, and Europe Cafe, and Kapulski Cafe, and the cinema. And the building nearby were shared, and the whole area was shared by Jews and Arabs. And the cinema, and Zion Cinema, which was opened in the early 20th century, it was not just a cinema. Let's say political meetings and the debates or protest against the British administration were managed in Zion Cinema. There were few others, but this was the main one. But not far from Zion Cinema, down the road towards what we call the Generali building, there was the Rex Cinema, very closer to Jaffa Gate, which was a typical Arab cinema. So you could you could watch typical Arab films in Rex, and you can watch the best modern West films in Zion Cinema, and it's a maximum 5 minutes walk between the two cinemas. The Zion Square was just an extension of the old city outside, and then the city developed along Jaffa Road to the west, far to the west, to where today is the main entrance to Jerusalem from the west, and there is the Lifta and Romema, the new train station that hopefully one day will operate a rapid train 20, half an hour to Tel Aviv, dream. Maybe one day it come true. And this was the city center. So you can find shops, let's say, shoe shops, two Arab-Palestinian, one Jewish, everything, you know, nearby. Houses, the buildings, were owned, many buildings in this area were owned by rich Palestinians. And they rent apartments or part of the building to, let's say, lawyers. Let's take, there is a, in Zion Square, there is a building called Sansur Building. Up to date, it's well known Sansur. Sansur was a very rich Palestinian Christian from Bethlehem. He invested, built this big building and rented apartments which became offices. The best lawyers in the city and in the country has their offices in Sansur Building. Both Katan, the Palestinian, or Cheshin, the Jew. And the lawyers and clients and the Brits sat in Europe Cafe, which was down the road in the Sansur Building. So it was very, very cosmopolitan, and it created a very, very different society. Now, the tragedy of 48 war is that the 48 forcefully divided the Jews from the Palestinians. It did not happen overnight. Gradually from 45, from the end of World War II, when more and more terrorist attacks happened, both Jews and Arabs implemented terrorist attacks, it became dangerous to be outside. There were curfews, checkpoints. The Brits put roadblocks and checkpoints and curfews in the evening and so on. So gradually, 3 years, the city became more and more divided. And then 48 war just finished what started in 45, and the division between the two sides ended. Now, what happened, what's very interesting, what happened after 67? 67, once again, the city opened. So 10 minutes walk from Zion Square, there is a Jaffa Gate, maximum 10 minutes, and there is no, anymore, there is no border in Jaffa Gate between Israel and Jordan. Jerusalem does not end in Jaffa Gate, but still the feeling of crossing into a different city is there. Actually is there. No one can say that he or she feels Israeli Jew feels the same in the Eastern city. The feeling is that you are in a different country, different environment, unless you enter into this Jewish quarter, the old city Jewish quarter. Apropos, one note about quarters. The perception that we have a wrong perception. I had, when I started studying the subject, I had the wrong perception about the quarters. My perception was, and perhaps you have also, that Jerusalem always had exclusive quarters, Jewish, Muslim, Christian, and so on. That's wrong. Many Jews lived in the Muslim quarter, Muslims lived in the Jewish quarter. The concept of quarters, exclusive quarters, is very, very wrong. It was inaugurated or promoted by the Brits. Unfortunately, by the Brits, coming from outside with colonial concepts and British concepts of the, let's say, minorities in the UK, and they each religious minority has its own representation and its own leadership, etc. So the colonialists decided to divide the society and to rule it according to ethnic religious identities. So they, but this was not the case on the ground. Actually, this was not the case in reality. So the concept of exclusive ethnic quarters is very, very wrong. Then the Israelis occupying the old city in 67 wrongly decided to create or rebuild a Jewish, exclusive Jewish quarter in the excuse that this was the reality up to 48 war. So we have to evacuate all the Palestinians from the Jewish quarter in order to rebuild the historical Jewish quarter, which was exclusive Jewish. Okay, so wrong perceptions, some historical perceptions, sometimes create tragedies. And they are very, very wrong historically. There was never was in modern times, never was a pure Jewish quarter or a pure Muslim quarter. Many, many houses in the Muslim quarter were inhabited by Jews.
One of the biggest problems of Jerusalem today in respect to its citizens that they are not equal. They don't have an equal legal status. The Palestinians are residents, and they are not residents forever. In the moment they leave for a specific period of time, they have not a secure right to go back and have a right to be residents of the city. And with this inequality, the gap will be deeper and deeper, and I would like to ask you, and I think that's a very difficult question, do you think there is still a perspective of uniting the city, not as you say in the book, divided, but to create one city with equal rights to all the citizens, whether there will be a Palestinian state or not? I mean, the city politics, is there a perspective, or do we have to wait for another 70 years before we can sense a change?
No, there are two, okay, so it's very fair, very good question, because there are two models to promote equality in Jerusalem. Equality between two municipalities, so letting the Palestinians establish their own municipality, capital, state, and rule themselves by themselves in Jerusalem, or providing full citizenship and closing the gap between Jews and Arabs, Palestinian Arabs in Jerusalem. Now, I don't see the second option. I don't see it happening. The conflict in Jerusalem or in Palestine is an ethnic conflict. This is an ethnic conflict. It's not a holy war between, as it was in medieval times, between religions. Okay, we are not in the Crusades time or whatever. It's not a war about who owns the theological truth, whose prophet is the real prophet, on who speaks on behalf of God and who claims to speak behalf of God. Okay, this was a hot issue in the medievals. This is not the problem today. Today it is a conflict between two ethnic groups. Each of them uses history and religion in order to further base its argument. The Israelis enjoy upper hand. They occupy and rule the Palestinians. I hardly can see that they will create an equality, or they are ready to create an equality. I was just data very telling. In Jerusalem, we have about almost 40% of Palestinians are Jerusalem residents. They are not citizens, they are residents. The municipality allocate to them between 9 to 13% only from its budget. So almost 40% of the population get around 11% of the municipal budget. Okay, this is the Palestinians are discriminated systematically for many reasons, but first and foremost because they are ethnically different. Nationally, ethnically, very different. Now, what Israel made in 67 is Israel annexed the territory, but not the people. Actually, this is exactly what Israel made. And Israel provided them residency, but not citizenship. If I would say, okay, I can say that Israel took the land, provided citizenship to the land, but not to the people living on this land. So the status of the natives, the Palestinian natives, is as a foreigners from the Israeli legal perspective. Recently it started to change. There are a few high court judges that recently put in two cases the verdict. They say, no, perhaps they are special residents because they are natives. We cannot relate to them as coming from abroad. By the way, the judge who wrote the verdict of the East Jerusalemites as foreigners coming from abroad was Aaron Barak, that is perceived to be the most liberal high court judge and revolutionary liberal high court judge. It's a wrong perception, but it's important to know. So the natives are like, you know, German journalists that have a green card or residency permit to work in Jerusalem, and they are discriminated systematically by the Israeli rule, and Israel is what also changed recently is that the Israeli right-wing government, the present government, acknowledged that they have a problem in Jerusalem. It took many years for them to open their minds and to acknowledge that they have a problem. I mean they, because they claim that Jerusalem is united and it will remain forever under Israeli sovereignty. But you cannot argue that the city is a binational city. It's not a united city. If you have 40% non-Jews, non-Israelis, non-citizens, this is not a Jewish city. It's not the capital, the Jewish capital of the Jewish city. And if you do look on, let's say, what happens on Saturday, you see that East Jerusalem open and everything is normal. West Jerusalem is closed. If you happen to be in Jerusalem during Passover, which the Israeli law prohibited selling and presenting in chametz or bread in Passover, you cross and you can buy pita as much as you want in the East, or bagel in the East City. So it's so different, so non-Jewish. And it's not 5%, 10%, 40%. In the state of Israel, Jerusalem has the biggest Arab-Palestinian minority in the state of Israel. And in no other place, the Palestinians are, or the Israeli Arabs are 40%. Neither in Haifa or in Jaffa, in no other mixed city, Ramla or Lida, or Beersheba. So this creates a problem. But the Israelis for many years, and Labor, Likud, never mind which government, which municipality, which mayor, they lived in a denial. They refused to see that here there is a problem and we failed. We Israelis, we government, as a society, politics, we failed to create a united Jewish city. Demography speaks. Demography rules and creates facts on the ground. So recently, the most radical right-wing ministers acknowledge that we have a problem. So here comes the Jewish wisdom, the trick. What is the trick? Let's re-engineer the city boundaries. So let's recreate the city boundaries, exclude part of the Palestinians from the city, from the municipality of Jerusalem. Okay, let's put them in a different municipality or district or whatever outside Jerusalem, and bring in artificially, include in Jerusalem some settlers or many settlements. And then when we count how many Jews and Arabs are in Jerusalem, we are in a good terms. Fine. So engineering, demographic engineering. It's not changing the reality on the ground. It's changing the calculation. Okay, so you see how the right wing tries to play and to continue living with the illusion that, okay, we can live with it and we will continue saying that this is a Jewish city and so on and so forth. Actually, in the space, in the area, Greater Jerusalem, there is with the settlements, demographically with the settlements, there is almost equality. But it's not 40-60, it's 50-50 demographically. Now, the main problem is, as you said, is that on the certain area, there are two ethnic collectives, two ethnic groups with a different legal status. That's the problem. And it's the different legal status is not because of the individual different status. So here, my status here in Berlin at the moment, I am a tourist. You are citizens, okay? But it is individual, it's my individual status because I entered from outside, I have a different citizenship. And I am allowed, but it's for me individual, not as a collective. In Jerusalem, the different status of the Palestinians is given as a collective. And this creates what John Kerry said in his farewell speech, different and unequal. That's the problem in Jerusalem. And this will not disappear. Whether we exclude them from the municipality and create for them a different municipality or regional council or whatever, they are still annexed to Israel, and as a collective, they have a different legal status. So at the same area, you will have the Shuafat refugee camp or the Shuafat area, which has one legal status, deprived, second-class resident, and its neighbor, a Jewish full citizen with the different status as a collective. So this, let's say, reminds John Kerry the segregation policy in the South in America. For others, it's a type of apartheid.
Yeah, and giving that, I must admit, the situation is quite peaceful. I mean, if you really try to understand what's going on there, to my big surprise, it is more peaceful than it could be and this is very strange. But I want to invite you, you have the chance now to speak to a real expert on Jerusalem. You can ask anything you like. Any question in each language, we'll translate it, and you'll get the answer to something you always wanted to know and never dared to ask.
It's more a remark than a question. I think only a few people in the world care about Jerusalem, but if it's divided or reunited or united or whatever. Okay, some million in the world do, like Jewish people in New York, but seeing 7 milliard or a billion people in the whole world, it's only a few. So can you see that in the way I do?
You mean that, tell me if I understood you. You mean that you care less about if it is divided or not, because for you, Jerusalem is something united, or you have some your perception of Jerusalem in mind?
I share what you said at the beginning. When you stay in Jerusalem, you feel more tension than you feel in Tel Aviv. But that's very often the case when you spend your time in open cities next to a sea and beach. It's more open than cities like on the mountains or whatever. But when you read on the newspapers, you have the impression Jerusalem is always on the titles. But if you really ask populations, people or whatever in the world, do you care whether Jerusalem is united or not? I think most of the people would say, no, I don't care. So governments, even my government, my German, pretend to care about it. Because it's what we called here a German government principle that we care about Israel and so on. But really and honestly said, I don't believe that those pretenders who say we care really about it, they okay. care only about if there will be war or not, because a war might rise up the oil price. And that's all.
Okay, now I got it. Here are two elements. One, governments deal, or political leadership deals with political problems, okay? And what is hot in international politics. So if the Israeli-Palestinian conflict wakes up and Jerusalem is in the center, then international politicians, institutions, they care about the conflict there. And when everything is quiet, there are much less, because it's not a burning issue. They have much more urgent issues here with coalition building or Greece, the problem within the EU, or Brexit, or whatever, okay? So this is from the political elite perspective. There is another perspective, because the view from outside is very different from within. When the tourist comes to Jerusalem or elsewhere, a tourist has a different perspective than the local. You cannot, definitely the political institutions or diplomats or journalists that come from outside and don't stay there for long, the reports that they send is the reports from the outside, unless there is a conflict. If there is a conflict, a bloodshed or a tension, then it creates a drama. And media likes very much drama, because drama sells. Okay, drama sells. You buy newspaper or you watch news in the TV because there is a drama. Okay, so during the drama, and then there are commercials in the news, and the drama attracts. But you don't have a normal life without drama. They are very rarely, I would say, very rarely represented in the media. So fewer people watch documentary films than news in the TV, because the news is drama. Documentary film, yeah, can be dramatic and can be on everyday life, not a big story.
Cilly, you mentioned that the city right now is peaceful, but I think there is a trauma going on you didn't mention yet. It's about this settlers movement in East Jerusalem. Maybe you can allude a little bit on also on the how they're legitimized and what is going on in this respect.
Oh, thank you very much for bringing it up, because it relates to what I said earlier. In the late 19th century, early 20th century, up to 48, as I said, Jews lived in all parts of Jerusalem, in the Christian, in the old city, okay? In the Christian and Muslim quarter, and Palestinian Arabs lived in West Jerusalem, where the Baqa or Talbiyeh, tens of thousands. And what happened is that the 48 divided the two societies. So the Palestinians left to the Jordanian area, but became Jordanian area, okay, to the old city or outside the old city. Jews living in Palestinian-dominated areas went to the west, and that's it. So, the properties, the Jewish properties in the Jordanian area became under the custodianship of the Jordanian custodian of the absentee people. The same happened in West Jerusalem. Now, in West Jerusalem, the custodian at first let Jews take Palestinian houses, and later on sold to them, to the residents, these houses, okay, in the private market price. After 67, the law was changed or amended that. It is in force up to date, that a Jew that once owned a property, a house or building or an apartment that became under the Israeli custodian, that was once Jordanian custodian, before that it was owned by Jew, anyone who owned it can get it back immediately, and the custodian has no way to stop him getting back or return to his property. Or in other words, the Jews have right to return or to rehabilitate the property, get back their property, but the Palestinians cannot. Now, after Camp David, when the city, or the first time the division of the city was raised between Jews and Arabs, and it became, let's say, at least theoretically or publicly, it became common to discuss, let's divide the city and what is Arab to the state of Palestine, and the Jewish quarter under is will be remain Israeli. Settlers went to the successors of Jews that owned once a property in that now was in Jordan, okay, up to 67, and said, we want to get it back. Authorize us to demand it from the government, from the custodian. And in order to settle inside Palestinian neighborhoods, in order to prevent the division suggested by Clinton and others, legally, they are right. The court can do nothing. The court really can do nothing, because the legal system provides Jews to implement the right of return and prevent Palestinians to get back their property in West Jerusalem. So the problem is political, not legal. And here the settlers use the legal mean in order to prevent a political solution to Jerusalem. And they make it in the Muslim quarter, they make it in the Christian quarter, they make it in Silwan, elsewhere, wherever they can. The number of settlers is not that high. It's about 2,000, maximum 2,200, and so on. But it creates a very, very bad relations between the majority nearby of the Palestinians, Arabs, and the settlers, which their ideology, the religious national ideology, is very hostile and different. They are not Arab Jews of the early 20th century that coexisted with Arabs. They are very, very different in everything. So this creates much more tension, but the problem is not legal. Now, the government is behind this settler NGOs, the settler organization. It goes back already to the 80s, when the government encouraged settler associations to do that and even fund them. But then it was done by labor governments, Likud governments. It was done secretly. Now it's, you know, proudly open with ceremonies, with media, with everything. And this is the doctrine. But this cannot solve the problem. This just creates a bigger problem in Jerusalem. So the issue is, actually the issue is not legal, it's political. And it, unfortunately, in Israel, this only the Jewish society, there is a denial of the Palestinian refugee problem. So very few Israelis, I write it in the book, but very few Israelis acknowledge that up to 48 war, about 22,000 Palestinians lived in West Jerusalem, southwest Jerusalem, and only 500 or 600 Jews lived there in southwest Jerusalem. All southwest Jerusalem, if you go to German colony and Katamon, the Greek colony, all this area was Palestinian, actually Palestinian. And the most nice houses of Talbiyeh were Palestinian houses. And Israel denies the right of their owners to get back their properties. That's the problem here. This is this one of the discrimination, and it's something. And okay, let's say that we cannot roll back history, okay, fine. But Israel denies even that once these houses were Palestinian. Israelis, when they write about it, when there are houses from within, I have a whole chapter describing how the municipality publishes the project House from Within once a year for a weekend. Many houses in Jerusalem are open for visitors, houses from within. And each house is described in a booklet. So the Palestinian past of these houses is deleted, actually deleted. An Arab house, an Arab architect, unknown family, very, very known, I must tell you, very known. But there is a denial in the Israeli society, and of course discrimination, and this creates more problems than solve it.
I wanted to follow up on the question on how to achieve equality, or at least a measure of equality in Jerusalem, and link it to the upcoming municipal elections. Now, for the first time, we have a joint Jewish-Arab list running in Jerusalem. And I wanted to ask you, Menachem, if that is a way of maybe addressing at least some of the questions of equality in Jerusalem. For example, you spoke about the budget and how the budget is distributed. If you had 40% representation of Palestinians in Jerusalem in the municipality, that could change. But of course, there is a reason we don't have that. So my question is, what is your expectations with regards to that list, and if it were successful, could it actually achieve change?
Okay, as far as I am informed, this initiative enjoys good PR, better reputation abroad than among the Palestinians in Jerusalem. There is a, let's say, a counter wave and delegitimizing the joint list. Many Palestinians refuse, and also let's take the numbers. Okay, I think it's there is no option whatsoever that any Palestinian list or even joint list is Israeli Jewish Palestinian can get 40% because they are 40% in the population, because the Palestinian population is very, very young. So the at most, let's say half of the population does not have the right to vote because they are under 18. So at best, let's say best case scenario, they can get 20%, 25% at a good day of reaching out to the polling station, okay? Which is also a problem there. Okay, to bring them to vote, to activate, create a political awareness, to care about their future and believe that they can make it, at best they will get 20%, 25%. Now the question is whether they will be asked to come to a coalition. There is no way that Zionist list will include Palestinian residents of Jerusalem in a coalition. No way. The discrimination will continue. No way. Take, for instance, even in the Knesset, where we have Arab, Israeli, Palestinian citizens, not residents, just residents, citizens, they never were part of the coalition. Well, okay? So very rarely, only few cases, the Israeli government included an Arab minister, but the Arab minister never was in an Arab party. It was never was an Arab party member, either Labor or Likud. It was in the Likud only Druze. They don't have real Arab. They have Druze. And the division between the Arabs and the Druze is very deep. It goes back to pre-statehood and the cooperation of the Druze with the Haganah militia, the Jewish militia. So it's built in and rooted. And the Palestinian leadership decided to oppose the joint list. There is no way that they legitimize it. The majority of the... take another indication. Let's assume that the could be theoretically a Palestinian list running in municipal elections in Jerusalem, forthcoming November, that the Israeli joint list, the joint list of the Israeli Palestinians, the Arabs, the Israeli Arabs, that is represented in the Knesset. The joint list decide we run in Jerusalem in order to get the votes of our Palestinian compatriots and struggle for them in Jerusalem. They don't run. There is no local list of the joint list running in Jerusalem. This is a very clear indication of the delegitimation to cooperate and legitimize the occupation by running into the elections. And I see it's a pity that these two guys, in my view, it's very pity. They want to do something very positive, but sometimes goodwill is not enough. You have to be also realistic to see what the society feels and what are the chances to... even Meretz in Jerusalem is unwilling to include in the local list a Palestinian. Okay, so it's a huge problem. It's a huge problem in Jerusalem. Now the city itself, the social combination of the cities, 40% Palestinians. Among the Jews, we have 30% ultra-Orthodox or different Orthodox, all kind of Orthodox Jews, religious Jews, really. And we have conservatives, let's say about 25 or so, and 20, 25, and then we have maximum 10% of seculars.
One day the fast train to Tel Aviv will be ready. And I read in a feature article by the Jerusalem Post that the fear is that exactly these secular and open-minded younger people are going to move from Jerusalem to Tel Aviv, whereas religious, more conservative people who are now located in Tel Aviv but might work there will move to Jerusalem because it will be so easy to commute. So what is your outlook on Jerusalem in, say, the next 10 years?
I wonder if you could say some words about the political point of view and attempts of this politician who had been murdered. I think his name was... I just forgot it. And he wanted to have a dialogue or a form of agreement with the Palestinian. Yes, that was it. And I wonder if you could say some words about his ideas, as I don't know enough about it. You quite see that. Rabin, yes. Thank you.
Okay. First, the question regarding the young generation. There is a counter trend. You are right. There is a trend of young people moving to Tel Aviv, but there is a counter trend of local patriots. Very interesting counter trend of young Jerusalemites they call themselves. We wake up. And we are very proud to stay in Jerusalem. We want to stay in Jerusalem, and we will struggle to have a different city and create a tolerant, open city, etc. So, and one of these young people is now running to mayorship. So it's very interesting. And in the last local elections, they did very well because the conservative they attract not only seculars but also conservatives. So they across the religious lines there is a cooperation across the religious lines, and so they are there and make a lot of noise. And since they were part of the coalition, they could get some project done in the city and so on. So it's there are changes. Okay, there are some changes. So which leaves optimism in this way. This is one. Second, with the train, with the half an hour, 40 minutes. Commuting between Tel Aviv and Jerusalem, it will ease the crossing between the two cities. So maybe many more Jerusalemites will live in Tel Aviv but come to work, but it can be also the other way around. So Jerusalemites working in Tel Aviv but continue to live in Jerusalem. Today also there are many high-tech people and so on that they commute on daily base to Tel Aviv area. So a train can create a big change. in this. So I don't see the problem is political, and the definitely political settlement can ease the tension and keep many more Jerusalemites in the city. The tension brings people to leave the city. That's the problem. That's the problem, in my view. Now, regarding the Rabin, your question about Rabin, I must say, Rabin perception is very different than real Rabin. Okay, so real Rabin was not ready at that time when he was murdered, was not ready to divide Jerusalem. He was behind the decision to build the big neighborhood settlement Har Choma, which is a huge problem because it divides between Arab area in East Jerusalem and the Palestinian cities of Bethlehem, Beit Jala, Beit Sahur. It's just to divide and rule the Palestinians and not let them create a continuity from Bethlehem to the eastern city, to their city. He was not ready to divide Jerusalem, definitely not. But the legacy or the perception is that he was in favor of a final status agreement and the peace agreement and so on. He tried. But he was not ready at that time when he was murdered. He was not ready to divide the country, to have a Palestinian state, full sovereign state, and so on. He tried to also, okay, to make justice also to another politician. Also, Peres enjoys much better PR than the real Peres. Okay. Peres, according to those who worked with him on Oslo agreement and even later, Peres all the time thought bringing in the Jordanians, not having a full sovereign Palestinian state. How to bring in the Jordanians? He was not also ready, and he even I think it was the few months before he ended his term as the president of the state, he negotiated with King the Abdullah on a kind of an agreement, and Bibi Netanyahu agreed to that he will go and check the water temperature in Jordan until it was too dangerous, and Bibi said, "No, stop! I don't authorize you," and that's he all the time he has a flirt with the Jordanians. Actually, he was not really convinced that okay, the Palestinians must get their full sovereignty in Jerusalem. So also Peres has better PR and perception than the real politician. But it's very difficult for the Israelis to come to terms, to conclude, okay, here are the Palestinians, they are people, they form up people like we are, and they deserve their own state with their own capital, fully independent. It's very problematic. And then the Israelis, for different reasons, some of them security, which has two parts, a real concern about security and a security as an excuse in order to continue ruling the other side. Okay, because, we do it for so many years, we rule them and we, ruling the other and giving advices to the others, including to the Europeans, how to manage, how to fight radical Islam in their countries, we are very good in this. So it's running in our blood to tell others what to do because we consider that we can do it much better than any other. It will take time, this is also behind, I think, the special relations on the excellent love story between Trump and Bibi Netanyahu. Because each of them thinks Trump thinks America alone, America first and last, and Bibi thinks America first and last, Israel first and last. Unlike Obama, Obama was internationalist, was a person that believed in international agreements, international relations and compromises. Bibi and Trump are definitely very, very, very different in character and in concept how to build foreign relations and how to manage national problems. So this is the problem, that we cannot see, that we cannot trust, we cannot see that we share with others, that we negotiate with others, that we cooperate with others, definitely not with the others, that we ruled them and told them, today you go here, tomorrow no. Today you are allowed to get this, but not that.
Well, unfortunately, these are very old people, and their time has run out. And my hope is on the many Israelis who are in Berlin and Frankfurt and Munich, who will go back sometime and having made different experiences, will turn the country into another direction, and maybe inter-ethnic marriages will help. So we'll have to support some traits in politics. I thank you very much for this interesting talk and the interesting book. And I thank you all that you spent the evening with us. And thank you.